Well, hello again and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my gorgeous, super intelligent, tri-state area loving wife,
what?
Michelle. What's that about?
Well, we'll be talking about that shortly.
We will, and it's going to be a lot of fun today, I'm telling you this. And by the way, Michelle, along with all of those things I just mentioned, she's also playing hurt today. She's suffering from a little bit of a, I don't know if it's a bug or the
allergies.
It's not the big C. Not even the other big C. Let's hope. Knock on wood.
Yeah.
But it is, you know, mostly probably allergies,
right?
That are just, so if she sounds a little nasally, you'll know why. But she is toughing it out because she is such a fan of our topic today.
I am a fan of the topic, and hopefully I'll be able to be coherent and not just every once in a while stare into space.
No, that'll be for me. I'm always the incoherent one. I'm always the one that's drifting off into space because something shiny went by. Michelle will do a great job with today's episode. Thank you for joining us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
why don't you sign up for our newsletter?
Yes, please sign up for the newsletter. We've had a lot of fun with many people who have subscribed to the newsletter. We put out different things about what shows are coming, what shows we've already posted. We put up the Disney Dishes blog, Recipe of the Week. By the way, I don't think I hit that up enough here on this show. Mm-hmm. Please, we do have another website, DisneyDishesBlog.com. There I do Disney recipes and some of my own that I kind of feel would fit into the Disney fold if they were to decide to, you know, ever, you know, contract me to do something for them. But we put out a lot of different food out there, a lot of different recipes, step by step on how to do it. So please go to the Disney Dishes blog to check that out. And if you subscribe to the newsletter, I do post a recipe of the week every single week.
Well, you do a great job on the newsletter. And also the Disney Dishes blog is really very helpful. Like Tom said, he doesn't just give a recipe. He gives the directions how to do it. He has step by step pictures. And I think it's awesome.
And I'm also willing to always answer questions. If anybody has anything out there or requests for things that are made at Disney, if I can find the recipe for it or if I can somewhat recreate it, kind of a copycat recipe, I'm always happy to do so. Also, please follow us on social media. We're really active out on social media. You can find us on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We are on YouTube. This show probably will be on YouTube. We have some music in it, so always a question whenever we have music in an episode, but it'll probably be there. If you want to find us on YouTube, you can just do a search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We'll pop right up. You just hit subscribe, and every time we have a video, you will be the first to know, and you can check it out at your leisure. And if you ever want to contact us for any reason, you can always email us at HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. We love to hear from you. Love to hear your feedback and input. If you have questions or ideas for other topics that you really want to know more about that we can delve into.
Yes. So please hit us up. We want to know, you know, we just want to be more in touch with you as often as possible. And the Gmail account is a great way to do so, as is social media, by the way. Just some house cleaning stuff here. We are still fundraising for the Broadway Cares Virtual 5K. We've joined the Parks and Monorails Most Magical Virtual Run team with others in the Disney community. Lots of great people. And we've done it. It's actually done amazing.
Yes.
Everybody has stepped to the plate and come through, and we've beaten our goal already, but the fundraising is going to continue. Now, we, coming into last week and through much of this week, we were in first place in fundraising and that, but, well, as we kind of expected would happen, some of the other teams have kind of stepped up and taken that, and they're probably going to win this thing. Disney Pick a Day, Lewis Davidson, he's up there. Dilos Diz, who kind of headed this thing along with the Monday Morning Monorail crew. They're both up there. As a matter of fact, Monday Morning Monorail, they did their 5K from Around World Showcase yesterday.
Yes.
They did a live stream of it, and they are now the leaders because of that. So they will probably win. But if depending on when you're hearing this thing, we still have till midnight Eastern time on Sunday, which it is the 23rd of August today. If you want to donate to us,
we
might still be able to pull it out. But even if you don't, we will be continuing fundraising for one more week. And we can't get the title belt, but we will keep fundraising. Now, we will still keep offering for $10 donation throughout this week for the magnets. And yes, if we do reach 500, we are $191 away right now. You will see me dancing in a kilt.
It'll be a treat.
It'll be a lot of fun. Also, just for this today only, up until that time, and this is just trying to give us a chance to win this thing, I am offering out there for anybody who donates from now until midnight Eastern time tonight. Again, it's the 23rd of August. If you donate $50 to us, I will do a personalized virtual cooking lesson for you, a Disney Dishes blog cooking lesson for you. So just trying to stir the pot, hoping that we can pull out a victory here, but also trying to donate for a good cause. And we will be doing that video I was talking about last week, where I will be doing dressing in a pirate costume, doing some songs that you have chosen. I will dance a little. I will lip sync a lot. And we've had some great suggestions so far. I'm going to put the poll out there early in the week to find out which song I should do. But I want to make one more suggestion as a song that I might do, because as we were doing our research for today's episode, this song came up and I thought, wow, what a great song this would be for me to do. So I'm going to, while you get to decide, I'm going to put this song out there as a possibility that I might want to put up there in the poll for you to see. Yes. So check this one out. I think this would be a lot of fun. You're the one who sets the bar, the hairdo king, the fashions are your fabulous.
I'm fabulous. You're fabulous. Oh, I'm fabulous. You're the one we all can see. It's all about you. It's all about me. You're fabulous. I'm fabulous. You're fabulous.
Anyway, I wanted to throw that out there as a possible suggestion, as a song that would be a lot of fun for me to get in the pirate costume. Maybe I could even get in some other costumes to play the other roles of Phineas or whatever in there, but I think it might be a lot of fun.
That is a great song to do a lip sync to, for sure, and in a pirate outfit.
So, again, I'll have that out there early in the week, and then by sometime mid-late next week, I will have the video released to pay up for us hitting our first goal in our fundraising efforts for the Broadway Cares Virtual 5K. Now, we were supposed to do the Virtual 5K this weekend. With Michelle feeling a little under the weather, we may be pushing that back till midweek or next weekend, but we will be getting that done eventually for sure. So, also, I wanted to mention one more thing. We recorded this week with another wonderful podcast, the Mouse Knows Best podcast. We had a great time with several of the members of that group. We did a draft of attractions from all the U.S. Disney parks and trying to build our own theme park each. They said that episode will probably air on a week from today, so the 30th of August, and we'll keep you more informed when that episode comes out, including links and everything, so you can find that. But we had a great time with them.
They are so fun anyways, and it was just an honor and a thrill to be able to do that with them.
So keep an eye out for that, because that was a lot of fun. And eventually we are going to be bringing several of their members onto our show because we just have a great time with them. So as for this week, well, we have lots of stuff for you today, including a major female film name has been signed to direct a Marvel film.
Nice.
And speaking of Marvel, a key landmark was put in place at a Disney park that is near and dear to us. And just a story that just came out recently. I saw this right before I came on, so it's actually not in my notes here. I'll probably have to dig it up here. But there may be another Disney private destination coming. We'll tell you for Disney Cruise Line. We'll tell you a little bit more about that. But let's get to our main topic of the week. We already alluded to it a couple times. It's going to be a lot of fun today because, you know, it's just going to be the best day ever.
There's 104 days of summer vacation and school comes along just to end it. So the annual problem for our generation is finding a good way to spend it.
Like maybe
building a rocket or fighting a mummy or climbing up the Eiffel Tower. Discovering something that doesn't exist, or giving a monkey a shower. Surfing tidal waves, creating nanobots, or locating Frankenstein's brain.
It's over here!
Finding a dodo bird, painting a continent, or driving our sister insane. As you can see, there's a whole lot of stuff to do before school starts this fall.
Come on, Barry!
So stick with us, cause Phineas and Ferb are gonna do it all. So stick with us, cause Phineas and Ferb are gonna do it all.
Mom, Tom and Michelle are making a Phineas and Ferb episode.
That's right. This is our Phineas and Ferb appreciation episode. Caught Michelle off guard with that one there.
That's funny.
She didn't know I was doing that. So we fell in love with this show actually recently, even though it's been out for more than a decade or whatever. Right. And we had some friends and family members who told us it was a great show.
And we didn't listen to them.
And we did not listen to them one little bit. But recently we were flipping around on, Disney XD or whatever before Disney Plus had come out, and we caught the Star Wars
episode. I'll be talking about that shortly. Yeah.
And we just kind of started watching a few, fell in love with it. Our son, Scott, it's one of his favorite shows. We put it on for him regularly in the evening. He enjoys it very much. We enjoy it together as a family. And if you're listening, if you're coming in and listening to this episode and hopefully, a whole episode on Phineas and Ferb. Why, we're going to try and go through it and explain to you why we love this show so much and why we think that you may love it too if you've never experienced before, or if you have and enjoyed it yourself, maybe some things that kind of may bring a little bit more to it for you, or we'll just kind of
you're taking over my show,
relive
now.
Some great moments. All right, I'm taking up too much of it. Yes, and by the way, this all has to do with Phineas and Ferb, the movie Candace Against the Universe, coming out on Disney Plus this week, this coming Friday on the 28th, and so that's what led us to this. Right. So now that I've stolen most of Michelle's thunder, let's get to her. She was excited to talk all about this, so let's get to her presentation of our Phineas and Ferb appreciation show.
Oh, how funny. Sorry, I don't mean to pull the hook on you there.
No, absolutely. I'm stealing your thunder, and I don't do that.
So I don't have a Phineas and Ferb shirt, but I did wear my Comic-Con shirt today, because that's actually where I had the opportunity to first meet that panel. I think it was in 2015. I'm not positive of that. But anyways, the interesting thing is I was going into that room at Comic-Con actually to hear the next presentation. And if you've ever been to Comic-Con or know about Comic-Con, you get kind of like squatter's right. So once you're in a room, they won't kick you out, but you might not get in a room if it's already full or whatever.
If
so
it's a really popular panel or whatever. And if you're in the room, you can gradually work your way closer to the front. As people leave, they've seen the panel they want, they go and they're like, okay, I'll take that seat up there.
Right.
You virtually move your way up if you are willing to stay in that room for longer.
Exactly. So this was also my first experience at Comic-Con. So I was such a newbie and trying to maneuver it. But this one particular room that I wanted to see a presentation, first was the Phineas and Ferb panel. And again, I had heard of the show. I thought it looked ridiculous. So I was like, all right, let me sit through this panel. And so the interesting thing, as we sit here today, I remember that panel. I remember the passion that came out from all the actors and writers that were on that panel. I remember them crying and sharing that love together because they knew the show was already done. It was kind of like a wrap up. And I remember that so vividly. I have no clue what the topic of the panel I actually went in that room for. But I do remember the Phineas and Ferb panel. And I think I remember telling you, wow, that was really powerful seeing them. You could tell they had such love for this show. And again, that along with family telling us that this is a good show, we still ignored it. Because again,
for a couple more years,
still very judgy of a book by its cover and just thought they looked weird and didn't give it a chance. And like you said, we did.
Yeah.
And we love it. So
I remember I couldn't go. I had to work that day or whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. And so you went. Mm-hmm. My son Nick went to the Comic-Con that day. I think you guys weren't in the same room that at that time.
No.
You came back and you told me about it and how it made you emotional as well and how you loved it. And we were thinking, and you said maybe we should watch this show, but then we never still got around to it until we stumbled across an episode a couple years later.
Right. You know, and the sad thing is, now that we do know the show, we know the writers or the creators. We don't know them personally, but of them and of the characters.
One of them liked one of our tweets, a couple of our tweets this week.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Swampy. but anyways, I think if I had the knowledge I have today going into that, I probably would have been a basket case after that, because it would have been very
knowing you. Yeah,
yeah, it would have
knowing
been,
me. If I had been
like I said, it touched me not even knowing anything about them. Mm-hmm. And I think if I had known, I would have been one gaga about being in the room with them and just loving their story. So
yeah, for sure.
As you said, though, we're really doing this episode in reverence of the upcoming movie that sounds like it's going to be amazing. And hopefully people are staying, like you said, to listen, because if you have seen Phineas and Ferb, whether you like it or not, hopefully there'll still be some fun things in this show for you. If you don't know it, hopefully this gives you some things that can really help you give the movie a chance even and really get something out of it. Because again, this is a great show. The characters are awesome. Everybody that's involved in the production of it really put everything that they can on it. And it's a wonderful Disney type of show.
Yeah. And it hits as like so many shows, like if you like DuckTales, the new DuckTales or whatever, several of the shows, it hits multi-generations. You know, there are jokes and visuals that'll hit your kids. There are jokes and visuals that'll hit your teens and tweens. And there are jokes and visuals that'll hit adults. And it just runs the gamut that you'll love. And I'm sure you'll just talk more about that here.
Exactly. So as we kind of mentioned, the creators of the show originally were Dan Povenmire and Jeff Swampy Marsh. They had actually been working together on various shows like The Simpsons and Nickelodeon series, Rocko's Modern Life. So they had some experience of working together on an animation type of a show anyways. But their idea of this actually was a brainchild first of Dan's, and it grew from there. So the funny thing is we have a clip for this of him describing his first drawing of Phineas.
Phineas was the first one I did, and he was literally just, I wonder if I can draw a character who looks like a triangle, because I'd worked on a lot of shows with different shapes, you know, and a friend of mine was pitching a show that had square-headed characters. And I didn't find it really appealing, but I was really, oh, that's really cool that he's trying different geometric shapes. And so I was sitting in a restaurant in South Pasadena, and they had butcher paper on the table with like a little can of crayons for you to doodle while you're waiting. And I drew Phineas by trying to draw a character. Like, I wonder if I could draw somebody who looked like a triangle. And I drew him, and I loved it. And I drew him three more times, took it home, and I drew the rest of the characters that night and took it to work the next day. And Swampy and I created the whole show from those original drawings. That was me trying to do something that I had not seen before. I think it's always good to do something new and different. But also, he just appealed to me when I saw it. I draw all the time. I'm constantly doodling. And occasionally I'll see something that really sticks in my brain. I was like, oh, I think I should do something with that. And that was what I felt about Phineas. Literally, I drew him. My wife said, ooh, who is that? And I said, and this is a direct quote, I said, that's Phineas. This is the show I'm going to sell someday. I literally realized that this is a character that looks so unique that we should do it.
So I love that story. Mm-hmm. And you can find online a picture of the butcher block paper where he drew Phineas three times.
We'll put it on the YouTube video, by the way.
Right.
And by the way, Michelle did another PowerPoint presentation, so she made my job a little bit easier when I'm editing the video, that I'm going to use her slides again like I did last week for the presentation. Yes.
Anyways, I'm a geek. So, but the interesting thing is he did that, but that show actually didn't air for 13 years. And, you know, and that one is an inspirational story that Dan Povenmire uses, you know, for people who are creative, who are looking at outlets of trying to have some kind of animated show, that it don't give up, that it might not be the first time you're presenting it. And he, you know, and he has described in interviews how he had made presentations to a lot of organizations, a lot of companies, you know, and sometimes got more and more interest as it went up the ladder, and then other times not. Disney actually said no the first time, and it wasn't until a year later where they actually invited him back to come talk about it, and eventually did purchase that, the rights to that. So, but the interesting thing is then when he went to work with Disney, he did notice that there were some elements that made it kind of difficult or different. The interesting thing is Dan worked with storyboarding, which was something that Disney had in their history of how they did movies. They just didn't necessarily see it as a way to do TV shows. But the other issue had to do with the voices, you know, having the executive producers actually do voices in it and music. So if we could take a listen to his interview talking about this.
I do the voice of Dr. Doofenshmirtz on the show. He's sort of the antagonist of the series. And they weren't going to, I did it in the pilot, and they were still wanted me to audition other people to do this in the show, because they had a rule that their executive producers did not do voices on the show, on their shows. And I was like, so where does that rule come from? I don't know. It's just a rule that we've had at Disney. And I said, well, how's that rule working out for you? Is it gaining you the people, you know, the talent that you want? Is it attracting the talent that you want? For instance, if Seth MacFarlane came in here and said he wanted to do voices on his own show, would you say, I'm sorry, our executive producers don't do that? And they were like, I don't know why we do that. Okay, well, maybe you can do the voice. It was the same thing. We wrote the theme song, and they were like, but our executive producers don't write songs on the show. And we're like, well, why is that? I don't know. It's just a rule. So is it a rule that we could get around? And they were like, I don't know. We wrote the theme song, and we wrote the Gitchy Gitchy Goose song for the Flop Stars episode. And we wrote the Perry the Platypus theme, and we played it for them at like the third pitch of the episodes. And suddenly they were like, we really like these songs. Can you write a song for every single episode? And we were like, yes, we can. And that's how I ended up writing 300 or 400 songs for Disney and over a period of 10 years.
Yeah, and they are great songs.
They are.
I mean,
they really are
amazing. There's a very eclectic collection throughout all their episodes of music, and you know, they hit on different genres of music, and anybody can appreciate, you know, their songs. They're really great, and they're funny and heartwarming, etc.
So. And some of them make you think. There's some really interesting, like, you know, brilliant things that are brought up within the songs that maybe you didn't know about, but it's really intelligent stuff that's
right
being described through their music.
Right. And they use songs to help the storyline along. They use songs to make fun of themselves or laugh at themselves, which is great. And you know, even for the upcoming movie, we saw on the trailer the song Such a Wonderful Day. Mm-hmm. And it's hilarious because they make reference to storylines that took place, you know, during the series.
Well, that's one of the things, and I don't know if you're going to get to this, but one of the things that's great about the show is how meta it is, that
yes,
it will often, you know, without going overboard on it, it'll reference itself, it'll make fun of itself,
right?
It'll make fun of, you know, how long the summer really was, because there were more than 104 days of episodes,
right,
worth of stuff. So, you know, there's just a lot of fun that you can pick up as you go through watching the show.
Definitely. So, you know, you may be asking yourself, you know, especially if you're an adult listener without kids, which is different than a
parents
parent
without
kids. Talk about meta. anyways, it still is a very fun and entertaining show to watch. Mm-hmm. And, you know, here are just some of the reasons why you might find this show very entertaining. You know, one, as we talked about, is the music. It's got very catchy music a lot of times, you know. It's edutainment. As you mentioned, you learn some things in the shows. They are very, very well written in that regards. It has smart humor. It doesn't talk down to kids. You know, it really elevates the level of humor. And like you said, it throws in adult type of humor as well. So it hits both kids and adults.
It also still will have some basic, you know, slapstick humor that kids may enjoy and get a kick out of as well. So
right. A lot of references to pop culture throughout, a lot. And in fact, there, and I went back and looked at the list, there's almost 20 episodes where they have references to Star Wars. They are big Star Wars fans. Mm-hmm. And they also do a lot of references to 80s and 90s pop culture in there. So it you know, you'll see things throughout their series that you'll, you know, attached to because of, you know, your life experiences as well. They have endearing characters.
For sure. You know,
they really are characters that you can feel good about watching them and seeing what they're doing in their life.
Not just endearing, they're multidimensional. I mean, not just the shapes of, you know, they are very interesting characters that have, you know, a lot of different true feelings. They a lot of different levels. People that, you know, you may watch one episode and think, oh, this character is such and such,
right,
you know, but as you watch 4, 5, 6, 7, 80 more episodes, you will find out that there are various different levels to virtually every single character you run across.
Exactly. And they do a lot to break stereotypes, mm-hmm, and, you know, really, again, you know, like you said, have depths to the type of things that those characters do. Mm-hmm. The other nice element about this show is they have great choreography. They do dance numbers like you wouldn't believe. Yep. And whether it's, you know, pup dancing, you know, or if it's, you know, Broadway style, like Rockettes come out and everything, it's hilarious. Yeah. But they do a lot of wonderful dance routines and great choreography throughout. And as we mentioned a couple times now, it's a great family show. Mm-hmm. It really does, you know, hit a lot of age groups. It doesn't matter, you know, whether, you know, it's boys or girls. It just does hit a lot of attraction to a lot of different, you know, age groups.
Yeah. Again, there's various levels to it. It'll hit every single person in the room in some way. Maybe not every episode, but there will be episodes that you will find the humor in. It will touch your heart. It will make you think. It's, you know, for what's basically a kid's show.
Right.
There's just so many. And I already mentioned it. There are just so many levels to it.
Right. And, you know, hey, if people have already watched everything that's out there on Disney Plus or Netflix or Hulu or whatever, why not give Phineas and Ferb a chance?
Yeah. It's a very bingeable show. Usually most episodes are two parts. So, you know, like a 12-minute segment and another 12-minute segment. So you can watch half of an episode. You can watch the full episode.
Yes.
Whatever the case may be. Some storylines carry on for longer than that. But most of them are about like that.
Right. So just to introduce people who haven't seen it to the cast. And it's a great cast, as we mentioned. And there's a lot of people. Really going to focus on the main ones. The ones where that really, again, drive the storyline for the most part. So obviously the first ones are Phineas and Ferb themselves. And, you know, they're two stepbrothers that are living together. And they're the ones that are involved in kind of starting the storyline of what is going to be done that day. It's a summer day and you got to do something that's big and exciting.
Yeah. Make every day the best day ever, essentially.
Right. Exactly. And they're joined by their sister, their older sister, Candace. She plays a 15-year-old. And she's very, very much preoccupied with wanting her brothers to get in trouble for all these outlandish things that they do. So she's big into busting her brothers. She may be crazy at times.
She's a little high-strung teen, yes.
Yes, yeah. But still her love of the family does come through.
And her brothers.
Right. And there are some episodes, and we're going to talk a little bit more about this later, too. But there are some episodes that, you know, it really expresses that even more so, that, you know, one of the things with Candace is when she's working with her brothers on something, they all seem to come together and have great success. It's more when she's kind of resisting what they're doing and not being in the moment with them that she finds all her craziness and, you know, neuroses coming through.
And she has some neuroses. I find her such an interesting character because you know, the fact that she's like, her life's goal is set out to essentially bust her brothers.
Right.
You know, she seems like she should be the antagonist and that you should really dislike her,
right,
and be rooting against her. And yes, for the most part, you probably are rooting against her. But there are many times you are almost rooting for her to succeed.
Right.
And if not in that, then the other aspects of her life. And that's what, you know, talking about characters with depth, I think that she has an insane amount of depth. You know, when the first time, a few times I watched it, I'm like, oh, I'm really going to dislike it, her. You know?
Right.
And the more we watch her, the more she became a favorite character of mine. And I know Michelle.
Oh, my
loves
God. Yes. I
Candace.
Do her. I love her. I really can connect with her and how she handles things, or where her brain goes, her initial thought of things. Totally on board with her on that. And so excited. The new movie is really going to feature her and feature actually in a different way, where her brothers actually have to come to her rescue.
Right.
So that, I'm looking forward to that.
For sure.
You know, she plays, you know, kind of your typical teenager of, she does like a boy in it, and, you know, she's always wanting to impress him and always, you know, kind of talks about, it shows some of the struggles of that insecurity, as a teenager.
Sure.
You know, am I
going
to
be... even as an adult.
Right. True. You know, am I going to be accepted, you know, and she has friendships, and it shows a lot of the dynamics of that. So like you said, she's an awesome character, and I could go on and on about her.
She could.
Yeah, I really could. I'm glad she's going to have a starring role in this upcoming movie, but we'll move on.
Mm-hmm.
So another...
by the way, voiced by Ashley Tisdale, who you may know from the High School Musical films that she starred in, among other things that she's done as well.
Yeah, she's great. Mm-hmm. She does an amazing job. And just listening to some of the soundtracks of in the trailer and everything, she just really got right back into that Candace mode and is brilliant in it.
Definitely, for sure.
So the next main character that plays a lot of how emotions come through in the storyline is Isabella.
Yes.
She is a fireside girl, which is, you know, plays on the whole Girl Scout theme and everything. And she definitely does have a love interest in Phineas.
Very much so.
Very much so. Interestingly, she's named after Dan's oldest daughter.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's a little Michelle fun fact. Yes. Michelle always has the best fun facts.
But again, it really shows depth of her being a strong individual, being, you know, somebody who can be caring and loving, you know, trying to help people through things. So again, another real great depth to her character. From what we're hearing about in the new movie, she's really showing her strength that's going to come out into that movie. So looking forward to that. We do have a little sound clip here of Dan talking a little bit about her.
In Summer Belongs to You, we actually have Phineas give up, which he's never done. And it was specifically so that this scene would happen, because Isabella, who is in love with Phineas, took him to Paris, and because it's the city of love, and she tried to sort of show him how romantic everything is. He just wasn't paying attention because he was trying to solve this problem. And now they crash landed on a desert island, and she's just been dejected this for the last like 20 minutes, and she's sort of crying by herself, and Ferb comes over just to console her a little bit. And she says, you know, Ferb, I was in the most romantic place in the world and he did not even notice me. I just feel so defeated. Look, even now, he's still trying to solve this problem. And Phineas is over there trying to figure out a way to get off this island. You know, like, oh, we could do this. No, we can't do that. And everything he's coming up with is coming up blank. And Isabella looks to Ferb and says, you know, and I would just give anything in the world if he would just sit down next to me and watch this beautiful sunset. because the sun's setting the thing. And the sun is also our ticking clock, because he's got to get home before the sun goes down in order to win this bet. And Phineas comes over next to her and says, or we can dig a trench. No, we can. I don't. And he sits down next to her and he says, I guess we can't do it. Well, at least we can watch this beautiful sunset together. And he turns to her, and she does not take that. This is the thing she's wanted more than anything in the world. But instead, she says, no, we are not going to watch this beautiful sunset. That is not the guy that I fell into this situation with. You're going to need it. And she talks to him, and she talks him up. And it's more important to her that he is the person that he is than for her to get what she wants. And that, like, I'm crying right now when I describe it. It's to me, that's a great turn.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm tearing up now hearing this again. And we watched, I don't know if you saw it, but I watched it because they're doing a marathon this mm-hmm. weekend of Phineas and Ferb Disney Channel, on Disney yeah. Channel. And not like we can't stream it yeah. at Disney Plus, but hey, anyways, they did play this episode, saw that, you know, that particular scene again. It brought tears to my eyes. Just knowing again, as I was mentioning, the people associated with this series have their heart on their sleeve writing. And I'm mm-hmm. not trying to make it sound like every episode is deep, because it really, it, if you just watch it for its, the superficial part, it's hysterical and it's a great entertaining. But when you can really learn to appreciate these characters and what they mean and what they mean to each other and how they bring the best out of each other, then you can love this show at an even deeper part of your soul.
Yeah. And we should have probably said before that, spoiler alert for Summer Belongs to You, if you haven't seen those, that series of episodes yet. But,
well, that didn't really give it away, because
that's really
not the
ending.
Away
everything. It just gave away a key moment in there, but it didn't give away everything.
Yeah. I could, knowing that moment, I could still watch it over and over.
Oh, yeah,
and,
of course.
And love for it. Sure, for sure. You know, and I think even now, you know, like after we heard that interview where, you know, Dan said this, it made me appreciate it even 100% more.
Oh yeah, completely. You know? And watching it again after hearing that interview, totally gave me a different viewpoint.
Right.
So good.
Exactly. So the last main characters of the series are Perry the Platypus and Doofenshmirtz.
Dr. Doofenshmirtz.
Dr. Doofenshmirtz.
Didn't go to either doctor school. Not for you to call it, for you to call him Mr.
So, so Perry is a spy that lives with the Flynn family, who lives with, Phineas and Ferb and Candace. And the family and the boys don't know anything about Perry's behind the scenes life. They just see him as a platypus that does nothing.
Doesn't do much.
Doesn't do much. And they mention that a lot.
But he does disappear every day.
Right.
For some, but it's expected. They're like, oh, where'd he go?
Right.
Oh, there you are.
But his whole mission in each episode is really to defeat Dr. Doofenshmirtz with his evil plans. And Dr. Doofenshmirtz, he's like a klutzy kind of evil scientist that, it's funny because all of his inventions do work, but they just don't work for him.
Right.
But his whole goal is to become leader of the tri-state area.
Right.
So a typical show has a very similar pattern, you know, not 100% of their shows, but most of their shows, as we mentioned, it's summer vacation. The two boys are sitting outside and they want to start the day by planning what are they going to do that day. They're aided by a small band of their friends, you know, Isabella being one of them, but there are some others. And their older sister Candace is usually spying on them, trying to figure out what they're going to be doing that she has to bust them for. And then simultaneously to that, you have the other storyline, which is Perry and Dr. Doofenshmirtz. I can never say it.
It's a tough one.
It is. Dr. Doofenshmirtz having this conflict between them on, you know, Perry's trying to defeat him. And at the end, the storylines intersect and...
Quite often. Not every time. Right. Quite often.
And then whatever that is happening that they're involved with Perry's actions, it makes the things the boys worked on disappear so that Candace can't bust her brothers because right. the evidence disappears.
Stuff always disappears or right. something goes wrong right at the moment when she's about to bust them.
Right, exactly. So just want to kind of touch on what some of their summer projects are. Not all of them, but some of them. And you may hear about them referenced a little bit in the new movie as well. And they reference it throughout the mm-hmm. series.
It's very meta.
Very meta. So the first one actually is the first one, which is building a giant roller coaster. And they actually do it multiple times. They actually have several episodes on it. And one of them is a musical, which is hysterical. Mm-hmm. But that is their initial verb. I know what we're going to do today.
Yes.
So another one that, again, they also reference in other times is they built a time machine, a very functioning time machine. And they utilize it to go back into time, forward into time. And it's, again, it's just, it's smart humor of how they do that and mm-hmm. how they reference it in, you know, in future episodes as well.
And little things will even pop up. Like I was watching one episode the other day uh-huh. and something that happened. I think it was actually the roller coaster, the musical, uh-huh. because it had happened after this time machine episode. There was a little thing in the parking lot that if you look in the background, you see it. And I'm not going to give it away in case you watch these episodes. But if you look out there, you're like, oh, that came from that one of the time episodes. You can kind of see
funny.
It in the background of the
right.
parking lot. It's really fun.
Yes. They build a shrinking machine and it actually had a purpose to try to help Isabella actually with something going on in her life with one of her, with her pet, but ends up that they are in Candace.
Right. Journey to the center of Candace.
Yes. She eats a sandwich that they're in and now they're in her. Yeah. And that's hysterical. Mm-hmm. They build a portal to Mars.
Yes.
And again, Candace gets in the trap all the time.
She gets sucked into a lot of these things.
Yes.
Often.
So not only is she frustrated because she's trying to bust her brothers, but then she gets sucked into what their activity is. And it's something that she has to deal with now on a personal level.
Usually like the boys didn't plan for it to happen. But
right.
because of the fact that she's trying to bust them or she's like looking in on things and she ends up getting sucked into this or putting into a rocket or whatever the case
right.
may be.
Right, exactly. And so like when she accidentally walks into the portal to Mars, she does end up being the queen of Mars.
Yes. As you'd would.
And similarly, did I say that right? Anyway.
Close enough.
Yeah.
Again, another tough word to say.
Yes.
Similarly.
Especially when you're not feeling well. Like my sinus, I'm like, am I hearing myself right?
I mess up similarly, regularly.
Wow.
You have to say it very slowly.
Very good. Enunciate.
Yes.
They build a giant ant farm and she goes into that ant farm and becomes the queen of that ant farm.
She becomes the queen of lots of different
yes.
people and species for
right.
sure.
But not always do the things that she gets involved in work so smoothly for herself. They build a video game, you know, and she ends up in that. And she's not queen there. She's struggling with that one. Mm-hmm. They build an entire beach in their backyard. It looks like the ocean there. And then the last one that wanted to mention is they build a growth elixir. And Candace gets involved in that because she wants to get taller so she could be considered the right height to be a model. Mm-hmm. So again, tying in some of those other elements of, you know, body image and mm-hmm. acceptance, et cetera, and how it turns out is really great.
Yes, for sure.
So now, as we mentioned, there are a lot of great songs. It's hard to narrow it down to a small amount.
Yeah, we actually started this episode. My first pitch for us to do a Phineas and Ferb episode was our five favorite
right.
Phineas and Ferb songs. But we thought it'd be better to more explore the show itself than just go through the music.
Exactly. But we do want to share a couple of them. And there's reason to also, one being favorites of ours, but also they are important in storyline and it may get referenced in the movie. So the first one we want to talk about is actually called Hey Ferb. And it comes from the remake of the roller coaster only as a musical. And in this episode, they actually are saying it's a remake. They're not trying to say, oh, let's think back of that. They're going to redo it, but now in musical format.
What we're gonna do today, though it might sound just a bit cliche, we can build a roller coaster, but this time with songs and dancing. Cause when we're back in school come next September, and they ask us, we can both remember every cool and clever thing we did all summer long and glancing. That we're gonna be so glad that we didn't sit all day and watch TV. I don't think anyone can disagree, the world is possibilities, and that's what makes me say, hey Ferb, hey Ferb, I know what we're gonna do today, hey Ferb, I know what we're gonna do today, hey Ferb, I know what we're gonna do today.
Not only is that a funny song, and it, you know, does explain a lot of things of their storyline, but if you're, when you're watching this particular episode of Phineas and Ferb, is they're actually singing this song, and they're in costume and sets of Hollywood movies, right. You know, like classic movies, yeah. Like Singing in the Rain and
King and I,
right? Yeah,
just several musicals, because this is the roller coaster, the musical,
right? Yeah. So, again, kind of laughing at themselves, you know, and again, great choreography there as well. One of the things I didn't mention, and that is a little funny piece of it, is Ferb, who is the stepbrother who comes from England, really is a man of little words,
right?
So that's why you don't hear a lot of Ferb dialogue. It's always Phineas the one that is initiating the conversation.
When Ferb speaks, it's almost always poignant in some way,
right,
shape, or
exactly,
form.
Right, exactly, exactly. The next song that is also a great song, it comes from an episode where it's their parents' anniversary. And this is one of the ones where the brothers, as well as Candace, are going to work together to regroup a band that is their parents' favorite band, like an 80s style band.
That broke up.
That had broken up, and they all had, you know, the band players had all gone their separate ways. And so there's this plot to get them together so that they can perform on a stage in the backyard.
Right.
And
a big, as you would,
yes, a big production, and this is one that, even though it is a big production and everything, that Candace does not, I guess I should say, she chooses not to bust her brothers and allow it to happen because of the love that she has for her parents, and that she got really joy out of doing this with her brothers. It was something that brought her a lot of fun. So this is when they're first starting to get the band together. They go to a library because that's where one of the band members ended up being a librarian. And this one is called Ain't Got Rhythm.
You keep saying that you don't have rhythm, but listen what you're doing right there. With that stamp and a book, you got a real nice hook. Sounds to me like you got rhythm to spare.
I have no idea what you're talking about. I've got as much rhythm as that chair. What happened to me was a tragedy, but I don't have to be a millionaire. Look, I got a sweet deal going on here. I got all the books that I can read. All these sweet old ladies in this carpet from the 80s. What more could a librarian need? Besides, I ain't got rhythm. No, I ain't got rhythm. Said I ain't got rhythm. I ain't got rhythm.
You're kidding me, right? You're kidding me. Don't you see what you were doing right then? That's a wicked groove you were starting to move. Mister, you got rhythm times 10.
I think perhaps that you're not listening. I find it tedious to repeat. It's no big drum, I just can't. time I'm telling you I lost the beat. I don't need my face on t-shirt or hit a power chord guitar. They were screaming my name, I guess it's a shame, but I don't need to be a rock star. Besides, I ain't got rhythm. No, I ain't got rhythm.
Seems like they ought to agree.
Ain't got rhythm.
But you're laying down some funky syncopation.
Ain't got rhythm.
But you got that
no,
beat.
Ain't got rhythm.
Look at them, they're stomping their feet.
Ain't got rhythm.
It's time for you to rock
a brand new generation. Gonna rock a brand new generation. Because I ain't got rhythm.
Would you just go join the band?
So good.
It is good. So, you know, again, all those percussion sounds in the library are hilarious. And I don't know for sure. I've never heard this in an interview, but I remember the first time I saw that episode, and that library scene reminded me of The Music Man, where there's a scene where the kids are in the library and, you know, they're dancing and things like that. And that's what's happening here. You know, I know this is a podcast where you're just seeing, you're just hearing it and you're not seeing the episode, but, you know, people are tapping their feet and, you know, tapping books and everything. So kind of very, I wouldn't be surprised if that's kind of one of their, you know, images that they kind of drew from. And that was Swampy.
Yeah,
so.
Swampy is the character's name, which is taken after Swampy Marsh, who is one of the writers. The other one, the other members of Love Handle are Dan, who is Dan Povenmire, who is also obviously one of the creators and writers. And then Bobby, who the song that I played early on, as I said, that for, you know, putting up for submission for my pirate video, which was fabulous, is another writer. The person that that was taken off is another writer who actually sung that song, Ain't Got Rhythm, is Steve Zahn, who you may know from the movie That Thing You Do. He's the guitarist and sometimes background singer. He does sing one lead song in there. But if you know him, you may know him. He's done several movies, but That Thing You Do may be the most popular one that he's done. But I one thing I love about that song also is the fact that it you can hear as the excitement grows, as he realizes more and more that he does have rhythm, that the keys change, the key keeps changing and going up as the excitement builds, and it does build the song. It's really well done, that whole episode. We may talk a little more about that. That whole episode is magnificent.
Yes We could delve into any one episode and have a whole podcast episode, but so that made this doing a broad spectrum of the series very challenging to narrow things down and be within a reasonable time frame to do an episode for us. So the last song of our favorites, there is going to be a little bit more music coming up, but the last song of one of our favorites is called Evil Boys, E-V-I-L-B-O-Y-S. In this episode, they're building a circus. It kind of built on the concept of Cirque du Soleil idea, and they're going to build this circus in the backyard, and obviously Candace wants to bust them for that. However, her boyfriend brings over a basket of vegetables, and it has parsnips, which she is highly allergic to. Maybe that's why I'm having allergy problems today. I'm zoning in on my Candace side here.
No parsnips in the house.
I'm actually not allergic to those, but anyways, and you know, obviously they're going to exaggerate the elements of her allergies, but she does have some issue with her voice, and now she feels she needs to hide herself so her boyfriend doesn't recognize her as the one with this deep new voice as a result of her allergies. And she puts a paper bag over her head and she leaves.
She also turns beet red.
Yes. And so she ends up still trying to go over to tell her mom what's going on in the backyard, that she's got to come check out because the boys are doing things wrong. And so she does it via song.
Candace, have you been near the wild parsnips again? yes, but you gotta see what Phineas and Ferb are doing.
What is it now?
Those boys are always up to something, and it's bringing me to tears, cause just before you get home, it always just magically disappears. Those boys are evil. But before you get home, they somehow always clean up the mess. Those boys are evil. Let me spell it out for you, Mom. E-V-I-L-B-O-Y-S. They built a roller coaster and a beach in the backyard. Drove cattle through the city and messed up the boulevard. They took me back in time when we went to that museum. They built 50-foot treehouse robots, but still you didn't see them. Those boys are evil. Their crazy shenanigans caused me all kinds of distress. Those boys are evil. Sing it with me. E-V-I-L-B-O-I-S. I know you think the saints, but Mom, I'm here to tell. The B-O-I-S, they're just E-V-I-L. Those boys are evil. They're making me feel like my head's in a hydraulic press. And that don't feel too good. Those boys are evil. Everybody, E-V-I-L-B-O-I-S. That's what I'm talking about. E-V-I-L-B-O-I-S. That's what those boys are.
Just such a creative way to continue that storyline of, you know, trying to get her mom to come home to see what the boys are doing, you know, and how frustrated she gets that they've done all these crazy things in the past. She still hasn't been able to see them. You know, she hasn't gotten her mom to see those things happening. And she's, you know, again, pleading for her mom to come.
Yeah, listing various things that we discussed, you know, again, meta part of the show, going back and listing all these various things that have already happened in other episodes. So good. Sung by Dan Povenmire, again, right. One of the creators of the show. He was in that interview and he claimed, like, I'm the only other person who has voiced Candace besides Ashley Tisdale when he did the Evil Boys song. But, you know, looking back at just the three songs we just played, you can see they're all different genres. Right. Evil Boys, obviously blues, Ain't Got Rhythm, a little bit more of a rock and roll kind of thing. And then Hey Ferb, more of a show tune, you know?
Right.
So you can see, and that's just three songs.
Right.
Again, all the songs run the various different genres of music. So many different ones. There's rap, there's reggae, there's all
there's
sorts
country
of stuff.
Country and Western.
Yes. Well, together.
And there's some, heavy metal music. Right. There is
classic ballads, right. Rock ballads. And
their talent is just phenomenal of how they can really capture all different types of essence of music. So really, really fun. And so want to talk a little bit about this episode here. You started a little bit earlier when you said that was our first experience with watching Phineas and Ferb. I think it was just one of those, we had nothing to watch and, you know, we're like, I think it was just trying to go to bed or something.
We're up with anything Star Wars. It's not Star Wars.
Right.
Oh, okay,
right.
Let's check it out.
Right. And so, I think it was playing on Disney XD or something like that. And it was about to start. And we're like, all right, let's check it out. It is different in that it is a 1 hour special. They first announced that they were going to be doing this episode actually at Comic-Con in San Diego in 2013. And so that, I'm sure, was an exciting panel time to be on. And Disney released a 5-song soundtrack from this movie. So, you know, it really was, you know, like a mini movie for sure. Some really interesting things, at least from when I was researching it. The opening crawl is voiced by Jim Cummings. Mm. So we know him from many things.
Voicing many things.
Yes.
Disney and Star Wars,
right,
for that matter.
Exactly. That they actually did take scenes from A New Hope, and I want to say this correctly, they directly rotoscoped it into animation.
Wow.
So,
cool.
They really, you know, I did see somewhere in an interview where Dan, when Disney bought you know, the Lucasfilm ability to show those films, that Dan right away sent a message to Disney saying, I see a Phineas and Ferb episode coming up. So it's exciting that they actually made it a 1 hour episode. There's a lot of amazing details. If you're a lover of Star Wars, watching this episode, and again, it was our first time watching it. We loved it after seeing it. And
it inspired us to actually watch a few episodes of Phineas and Ferb,
exactly,
when we eventually fell in love with it.
Exactly. But one example is they do have a scene where there is a band, like a cantina band playing, but they have electric guitars, but on the neck of the guitar are the little, what do you call them? Clue horns. It's part of the actual guitar that they have that on there. So a lot of little details like that that they use. And again, showing in the Phineas and Ferb series how they really pay homage to a lot in their episodes. The Death Star schematics have three prominent things written in Arbesh. Gosh, I can't talk today.
I think we're going to give you a pass. Your allergies are going crazy.
You.
Yes.
And interestingly, I'm going to read what they say, but I remember when we were watching it, we did pause to look at it and translate it, and then cracked up because of what the translations were. So the things that it said is, you got a joke no one else did. If you have paused this and translated this into English, congratulations. And now go impress your friends.
Yeah. So that's what we're doing.
But it was so funny that we actually did this. And then when we saw it, it just cracked us up. So there's also another unique connection between Perry and Captain Rex from Star Wars, and that is, it's the same voice. It's D. Bradley Baker.
Right.
So another good Star Wars connection.
One of D. Bradley Baker's deeper roles. I can't even do it. You know, that noise that he makes for Perry the Platypus.
Exactly. So, and again, they obviously are, as I mentioned, they have songs. We're going to play one of them in just a second. There's a little bit of a difference that Phineas and Ferb have with Luke. They are on Tatooine. They're in the dairy farm right next to Luke. but they actually see, they love staying on Tatooine. They see a lot of potential with it. And so they bring that out in this song.
Slice of heaven tucked between the jungle waste and the big dune sea. We can surf through the canyons or train a pack of doobags, build a giant hamster habitat for womp rats, or fire up our solar powered sandcastle making machine.
We're on Tatooine.
Yeah, we're living like kings out here. We got a Tucson summer to hold on dear. Cruising Beggar's Canyon in our T-16 or just sitting on a rock eating blue ice cream.
We got two big sons, count 'em, one and two.
Then there's two flame fetcher boys.
Well, we're brothers, we're STEM. No, we don't share a team, but we'll always be together here on Tatooine.
Jamming with the modal nodes, racing turbo dust bikes, trading with the Jawas, tricking out a droid or souping up the barge for a trip round Anchorhead Towers. We can stop along the way and startle Tusken Raiders and still be home in time to fix the evaporators. I think you know exactly what we mean.
We love Tatooine.
Yeah, we're living like kings out here. We got a Tucson summer the whole darn year. Cruising Beggar's Canyon in our T-16 or just sitting on a rock eating blue ice cream. Would want to leave. We know our Cindy climates and a tad extreme, but we're so happy here we tend to overstate this theme.
So, again, I know being very repetitive here, a great song. Their lyrics are brilliant, and it really is worth listening to them and listening to them again. And, I mean, every reference you can imagine, mm-hmm. they put in a song. And that, you know, I think really highlights that, that if you're a Star Wars lover, you got everything that they said, and it was all very poignant, and it all, again, it helped drive the story. Because at the base of it all, they're talking about a two-son summer, which their whole storyline is about summer vacation.
Right. And again, you know, so far, if you count the opening theme as far as songs, we've played six different songs, and none of them sound the same. I mean, yes, maybe Phineas is singing, so right. we get a little bit of the same voice or whatever, but as far as how the song goes, the lyrics of it, essentially, the tune itself, the genre of it, they all are a bit different.
Right. You know, and this song, I think, really reflects what we were saying, that it's smart humor, it's on different levels. You know, obviously, a little kid might not really pick up on all the little details about, you know, being home in time to fix the evaporators and blue ice cream, or, you know, all the things about racing and Jawas, etc. But if you're a Star Wars lover, you got every single thing that they said. And it was line after line after line mm-hmm. that they make these references. So, and that's the type of humor that you do see. It, you know, it has some funny things that the kids can definitely, and definitely imagery kids can attach themselves to and love. But again, this song was not written for kids.
Right.
You know,
it's for people who love, I mean, yes, you know, a lot of kids love Star Wars. They'll get all the references.
Right.
But for those of us who grew up watching A New Hope,
right.
you know, I mean, it's all references that you get. And
exactly.
So it brings you back to your own childhood right. a little bit.
So just want to go through a few more things on, you know, a newbie prep for watching the new movie coming out. And so, one way, you know, hopefully is listening to our podcast that can kind of help get you introduced to some of the characters, a little bit of their backstory so you understand what's going on in the flow of what their stories are usually like. But there are some episodes that you might want to watch. Obviously, one of them, which we talked about now, was Star Wars. Watching the roller coaster episode, especially the musical one, because I think you get a little bit more explained in that because of the music. And another one that we referenced earlier is Summer Belongs to You. And again, that one is also a little longer. But I think those, if you could only watch one or two, I would pick from those. And that could give you a good introduction.
Right. I would also suggest getting the band back together, I think, is an important one
right.
to watch as far as just musically, as we've played two of the songs from it already.
Right.
You
right.
know, it's a really great episode, and you don't need to know quite as much about the show to enjoy that episode, I think.
Right.
There's some episodes that I think you need to have watched a few more to kind of get the humor and get
right.
everything, all the meta stuff that's involved in it.
So. Right, right. But there are some others that we would highly recommend as well if you haven't seen them or haven't seen all of them. Unfair Science Fair is one of them. That's where Candace becomes the Queen of Mars. Mom's Birthday.
Yeah.
And that one will definitely tug at your heart. Mm-hmm. A Lawn Gnome Beach Party of Terror.
What a great title.
I know. Right? Don't Even Blink. That one is hilarious. And that was one of the songs that I almost included on our list here today. In that episode, and one of the things that's really funny is that Phineas and Ferb have no problem with Candace trying to show what they're doing to their mom. You
right.
know, I'm sure there's probably pride associated with right. that. They don't see it as that they're going to get in trouble as a result of this. They're just like proud of what
they've
come up
with. Look at this cool
stuff
we've made.
Right.
Yeah.
So they're willing to even help her in her quest to get them their inventions shown to their mother. And there's one where they build like a rocket ship kind of ride though mm-hmm. in the backyard, and one of the things that Candace is saying is that it's when you're all finished these things go away, so let's sit here and watch it till their mom gets home
right.
so that they can bring her out. And and that's where it's Don't Even Blink. And it's mm-hmm. got another great song in there. But all of the, you know, Phineas and Ferb, their friends that are there helping, they're all sitting there watching and looking at this thing to try to figure out, because I mean, that is something that they find curious too. It's like, where do these things all go? Why are they already just disappeared?
Right.
As you mentioned, getting the band together in Jerk de Soleil, which is the one we talked about before. So I have just a few closing remarks, but I don't know if you have anything else to add. You know, kind of like the present and the future. They're, in addition to Phineas and Ferb, the writers also did a crossover of Phineas and Ferb with the Milo Murphy's Law. Mm-hmm. And in that animated cartoon, it has Weird Al Yankovic in that. And
he stars
Milo in that, right? And he'll have a little piece, we understand, of the new movie. He'll be somewhat in that. In a recent interview on D23, with D23, that the writers did share that there is hope for more Phineas and Ferb in the future. It didn't sound like necessarily another series coming back, but maybe either another crossover or possibly another movie or some kind of special show or whatever. And, you know, we're just really thrilled that it's already 5 years since Phineas and Ferb ended. And they came up with a movie. And again, we also heard, or I heard in an interview, that they were really pleased that Disney did bring their group back together, but also really, you know, made sure that they had the financial support to make a great product, that they didn't feel like it was going to cut corners or anything like that, just to have something out there, that they really let, you know, these great artists come together and produce something that they are proud of. The other thing is, if you really haven't watched, all I can say is give it a chance. Don't be like me, where it's like, oh, they look ridiculous. It really is something that is very enjoyable.
Right. And don't just watch one show. It's like any show, especially if, like, maybe you just watch the pilot, which is the roller coaster episode. You know, if you just watch one show and that's your only chance you give it, that might, you know, it might not do it for you. Give it, you know, 3, 4, 5 episodes. Mm-hmm. So all the recurring jokes and recurring themes can kick in for you, because it's like any other show. It also grew, you know, it started off and it was good to begin with, but it gets better and better as they go through the seasons.
Right. And this year's Comic-Con at Home did have a panel where they brought a lot of the people together to talk about it. So that might be something also that you might want to be interested in seeing, whether as to prep to get to see kind of the behind the scenes people who are involved in this, and, you know, some of the voice actors, or if you already know the series, it's kind of fun hearing their stories.
Right.
And, you know, they do touch on, you know, some of the original history of the series, some of their own favorite episodes or parts to it. And one of the things I did hear shared in that, and they didn't go into detail, but what they did say is that Candace's name does mean something, and that's going to come out in the new movie.
Right.
So a little tease for that.
I'm very excited for that this week. Very excited.
Right. So anything that you think that needs to be covered here?
No, I think you did a really good job. And I think we discussed most everything I think about the show. I think it hits on so many different levels. Again, give it, it's very binge worthy show. Watch several episodes. Don't just give it one, you know, because there's so many things there's so much meta humor. There's so many recurring jokes that go through it that come up again and again and again.
Pop culture references.
Yeah, so many different themes. You want to, you know, maybe the episode doesn't have the song that hits your genre of music, but wait 3 or 4 episodes, you'll find a song that hits the music you like, and the interesting lyrics. And they're very rewatchable episodes as well, because there are a lot of things that will flash by you, little visual gags or little lines in songs, or just little lines of dialogue that you may not catch the first time, but the second or third time through, it'll make you laugh.
Exactly. So
give it a chance for sure.
Yeah. And enjoy.
Yes. Yes. So Michelle always does a great job with this. And we love Phineas and Ferb. We hope that you love it too, or that you will learn to love it. And we hope that you love Phineas and Ferb, the movie Candace Against the Universe, which we're very excited about. We are actually going to get a chance to watch it. Thanks to D23 and us being D23 Gold members, we're going to get a chance to watch it on Thursday, the 27th. So once we watch it, it'll probably be in the evening time. We will tweet out our initial thoughts on it. And then, of course, we'll talk about about more of it on the episode coming up that week and what exactly. Maybe give a little bit more of a review. So
right.
Very excited. So thanks, Michelle. Great job. As likewise. Always, Michelle always does the best job of these subjects. And to take us out on our Phineas and Ferb appreciation episode, ladies and gentlemen, Love Handle.
Should have known from how I felt when we were together, and even more when we were apart. You tiptoed in and you got under my skin. You snuck your way right into my heart.
Good. Again, credit to Dan Povenmire, Jeff Swampy Marsh,
yes.
The whole crew at Phineas and Ferb who write all these wonderful songs. They just, it's amazing. Again, another song, total 80s rock ballad.
Yeah.
You know, it's just so good. And all that music is so good. It's probably one of the things that we, I mean, yes, we love, you know, the characters.
Right.
We love the dialogue. We love the storylines. We loved all that. But I think we love the music more than anything
else. I know. And it helps tell the story, and hearing it again, it evokes those same feelings. Like I remember, you know, Candace putting her arms around her brothers that they had done a really good job for their parents. Oh my God. and Isabella being a ninja coming from above.
You know, her and the other fireside
right,
girls.
It's awesome. Yeah.
So
a lot of great imagery.
Yeah. Again, awesome episodes, all of them. Go check out Phineas and Ferb. Go check out the movie when it comes out on Disney Plus this week. You're going to love it for sure. So
exactly.
I think if you know us, if you're a fan like we are, I think you're going to find that this show is one that you will be, it will speak to you
right.
In many ways.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
Let's get to the, we've already spent a lot of time on Phineas and Ferb. So let's get to the Disney stories of the week. We have a few for you this week, and I'm going to start with a major female name has been tabbed to direct an upcoming Marvel film. Now, it's not a Disney Marvel film. It's a Sony Marvel film. But, you know, we like to branch out a little bit here and there. We love Marvel films. I mean, Spider-Man is technically a Sony Marvel
film.
Right.
Give dude where they deserve it.
Yeah. So this from Variety.com. Olivia Wilde has signed a deal with Sony Pictures to develop and direct an untitled female-centric Marvel film project for the studio, sources have told Variety. Representatives for Sony and Marvel had no comment about the project, but speculation has arisen in the recent months about Sony developing a movie centering on the Spider-Woman character. So
nice.
Really cool. Yeah, yeah, of course. Obviously, Spider-Man being right. Sony. Spider-Woman makes a lot of sense. The Spider-Woman title has been held by several Marvel Comics characters throughout the years, starting with Jessica Drew in the 1970s, whose origin story involves uranium exposure and spider blood. Wow. I've heard something similar to that before. And also, it also includes Mary Jane Watson and Gwen Stacy. Of course, the Spider-Gwen version of the character was seen last in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, the animated hit, a really great movie. That was voiced by Haley Steinfeld. The film will be written by Booksmart writer Katie Silberman, and with Amy Pascal producing. Rachel O'Connor will be the executive producer. Wild, of course, made her feature film directorial debut last year with Booksmart, which we were just talking about, written by Katie Silberman. Mm-hmm. It earned a Writers Guild of America nomination for the script for Silberman, along with Emily Halpern, Sarah Haskins and Susanna Fogel. Olivia Wilde has been in several movies and television shows, including Tron Legacy. Wow. She was in that as well. So really interesting. I'm always up for more Marvel and whatever a group that's going to do it. And this, you know, the Spider-Verse is very, very interesting.
And very popular. So, yeah, so that's awesome.
Looking forward to seeing what comes from that. Speaking of Marvel, there's another piece in the Avengers Campus puzzle at Disney California Adventure Park that was put into place this week. Disney unveiled pictures of a Quinjet.
Nice.
Yes, that was put in place in the new land currently being built at the park. The post showed the jet from a few different angles, including a really nice one with the sun kind of shining off the back of it. Looks fantastic. They had Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout in the background. Really looked great. There was a posed picture with Disney Park President Josh D'Amaro, Marvel Studios President Kevin Feige, and Disneyland Resort President Kevin Potrock. They're all in front of it. Masks on.
Yeah.
You know, and so construction is progressing. We don't still know when it's going to be opened or when Disneyland's going to be open for that matter. It was originally supposed to be open in mid-July. So we'll kind of see. Disneyland was also supposed to be open in mid-July, but we'll kind of see where it goes. But at least it's great that Avengers Campus is taking shape, and it looks like it's going to be spectacular.
Right. It is, you know, we are definitely missing Disneyland from being open, but it's great that they are still moving forward with the construction, and that when we do finally get to return, that there's going to be some exciting new things to experience.
Yeah, I can't wait for that land to open so much. Actually, we'll tie that space together where, because, you know, when they transformed Tower of Terror into Mission Breakout, it looked a little weird in the space that it's in. Now that you're going to have this Marvel area to connect to it, it should flow a little better within Disney California.
Right. It didn't have a connection with some of the other things that were around or within eye range of what was around. So this, like you said, will bring that to be a little more fluid.
Yeah, for sure. So finally, one last story for you. And like I said, this one came in just at the last moment. I saw it literally just a few minutes before we were about to air. So I'm actually reading this straight off the website. If you're watching the video, wonder what I was fiddling around with for so long, I had to pull up the website here. But this is from Disney Cruise Line blog, who, if you're a Disney Cruise fan, it's a great blog. Definitely check it out. They have all sorts of information, news, navigators from past cruises,
whatever. Tips.
Yep. Definitely go check out that blog. But this came in. According to a report out of the Bahamas from the Tribune, Pearl Island recently signed a deal with Disney Cruise Line to potentially offer cruisers the option to spend a day at a private beach. Pearl Island offers white sand beaches, a traditional Bahamian lunch, snorkeling, water play area, kayaks, beach chairs, and private cabanas. Pearl Island is located just 8 miles from Nassau and 1 mile east of Paradise Island and is known for its warm, crystal clear waters, stunning natural beauty, white sands, as we just talked about, and its iconic lighthouse. So it looks like Disney, until they finish Lighthouse Point, maybe, as these cruise ships coming in, they're looking for another possible location that cruisers can go to as kind of a private destination, or, you know, to have that wonderful pristine beach day.
That's
kind of cool.
That is cool. So does it sound like it's going to be an excursion type of activity or an actual...
Doesn't really say. It says, I'm continuing on with the story. It says at this time, Disney Cruise Line does not list any port adventures to Pearl Island. However, based on the news report, it seems like this may be an option when cruising resumes, as this would be a situation where passengers could ferry to the pier directly over to Poor Island. So I guess, yes. So it sounds like it will be, if you go to Nassau, right, my guess, that you would be part of this excursion and ferry over there. And, you know, if how many times have you, I mean, if you've done Disney cruising a lot, you've probably been to Nassau once, twice, 20 times, yeah, whatever the case may be. How much can you do in Nassau to have another option for something to do? I think that's great. Yeah, and actually that is something that's we might look into if we were going to do that.
Right. No, it makes sense because, like, as you mentioned, you know, Nassau is one of the, is the main stop when, for their shorter cruises, you know, so their 3-day cruises especially. And which is a great way to get oriented to a cruise if you've never done one. That is kind mm-hmm. of, you know, a standard, easy going one. And it does have some things to check out, but right, if it's one that you get to do frequently, you're like, I mean, for us, like you've said, we've seen it so many times, it becomes our pool day right, a lot of times too.
Yeah, but we're happy with if everybody just goes ahead and explores Nassau and right, we get the little bit more wide open space on the pool deck or
exactly,
on the ship itself.
Yeah. So, but it does sound like a really neat place to visit, and that's going to have some activities that'll be fun
yeah,
as well.
Cabanas, nice. Right.
Yeah, kayaking, yeah, et cetera.
All sorts of cool stuff. Mm-hmm. So interesting to see what comes of that and if that starts appearing as a shore excursion right, very soon. So. Cool. So that's it for the Disney stories of the week. However, we never leave you without giving you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation. And we always start with Michelle, one, because she's wonderful, gorgeous, plays hurt here on the show, as you've seen with her fighting through her allergy issues. But she always has the very best tip. So let's get to it. Here is Michelle's tip of the week.
You're so kind and generous. So it's a very short tip because I knew that I would probably talk a lot about Phineas and Ferb. So I tried to keep this
I talked for another hour.
Right. Yeah. It was hard not to. So anyways, my tip is more related to making dining reservations. And, you know, we realize right now with Walt Disney World that it's a 60-day window now versus when we used to have 180-day for advanced dining reservations. We also know with capacity issues that sometimes it might be challenging, especially if you're going either as a large group, you know, so maybe 9 people or, you know, more, or just 2 people. And so just want to give you a tip is if you're finding online some challenges with the table service of getting that kind of situation. I mean, I know some people when they have a large party, they may break it up into 2, you know, and do like a 2 tables of 8 or, you know, I mean, 2 tables of 4 or table 4 and 5 or whatever. That may work, it may not. Or if you're you know, you might see that there are reservations available for a table of, you know, 4 or 6, but not a table of 2. It's still worth calling and mm-hmm. trying to see if there's a way that they could accommodate you. They may not be able to, but they really do try. So I would say, if there's something you want to experience and you do see that they have seating, but it's not at the capacity that you're looking for, is give them a call.
Right. And they're always willing to help out if they right. can, if they can find a way to make it work. They will put out the effort to do that for
right,
sure.
Right.
Disney is very accommodating in that way. So,
right. So
great tip, Michelle. Always has the very best tips. my tip this week, I'm going to talk a little bit about Disney transportation, just kind of knowing Disney transportation if you have never been to the Walt Disney World Resort or if you've never been to the Disneyland Resort. Now, as far as Disneyland, once it reopens, hopefully soon. We're here in San Diego. We finally got the clearance to reopen some things this week. We're hoping that we keep the numbers down and schools can reopen here
right,
soon. We'll see
right.
how that goes. But things are starting to open up in California a little more. So hopefully Disneyland will fall soon. But if you are going to Disneyland, know that most of the hotels that are in the area, of course, there's only 3 Disney actual resort hotels, mm-hmm. but there are a lot of other nice hotels within the area. Most of them are within walking distance, so you don't need to worry about your transportation to and from the parks. Now, if you are a little bit farther away, or if it's, you know, maybe something that maybe you don't, you're not, you're already walking enough in the parks, you don't right. want to walk that much more, check under your hotel, because a lot of them offer shuttle right. service to the parks. Definitely check on that. The one thing I want to caution you in, though, is be sure to check in to what parking rates are there if you're driving into town or if you're renting a car or whatever it may be. Because a lot of the hotels do charge, you know, $20 a day, whatever the case may be, for you to park your car there. But there are some hotels, including one of our favorites, that offers parking included in the price of your hotel. So keep track on that in case you happen to be driving in. Now, at the Walt Disney World Resort, there are lots of reasons why you will never need a car there. All you're going to stay is in the Disney bubble. There are so many different forms of transportation. Now, I know most of you know Walt Disney World and you know about all this, but in case you don't know, or in case you're visiting there for the first time, I want to go over to some of the different forms of transportation at Walt Disney World. Of course, there is bus service from every Disney resort. Some have more of it than others, but there is bus service everywhere. Some run more frequently. Some take a little longer to get there.
To the parks.
To the parks and to Disney Springs. As well. There are several resorts that are on the monorail line. So if you're wanting to go to Magic Kingdom or to Epcot, you can catch the monorail from the Contemporary Resort, and that includes Bay Lake Towers, the Polynesian Resort, and also the Grand Floridian. If you're looking to get to Magic Kingdom via a boat, there are several resorts that offer that as well. The Wilderness Lodge does. Fort Wilderness, of course, where the cabins and campgrounds are, the Polynesian as well, and the Grand Floridian all offer boat service to Magic Kingdom. Now, they may not be running right now, but when things get back to more normal, again, I'm trying to put out transportation for you for when things are going out there, when things are running as we expect them to be. And the same goes with the Epcot and Hollywood Studios, the friendship boats that are there. They go from the Boardwalk, Yacht and Beach Club, and the Swan and Dolphin. And if you want to get to Disney Springs, if you're staying at Old Key West, Saratoga Springs, or Port Orleans, both the French Quarter and Riverside, they have boats that run right to Disney Springs. So kind of an interesting way to get there. There's also, of course, the new Skyline, relatively new Skyliner service that goes to Epcot and Hollywood Studios. The resorts you can catch those from are the Riviera Resort, Caribbean Beach Resort, Pop Century, and Art of Animation. And also now walkable, if you want to go to Magic Kingdom, you can walk right from the Contemporary and Bay Lake Towers to Magic Kingdom. We do it all the time. Really easy. And now, I don't know if it's open yet, but it's very nearly open if it's not already open. There's a new walkway coming from the Grand Floridian as well. If you want to walk from there, that looks like a little bit longer walk. But still a way to get there if you're looking for, you know, not having to fight with the transportation in some way. And so, again, you don't necessarily need a car. If you may be wanting to travel to some places easier, again, you're going to be paying for parking there unless you're on staying on Disney Vacation Club points. You will be paying for parking at your resort. So keep that in mind when you're renting a car. It's just not the fee for the rental car. You will need to pay for parking as well. But just to let you know, there are various transportation options throughout the Disney resorts.
And you can really find, you know, obviously once you're at your resort, you can get information about that on the app. Like, you know, it gives waiting times for the bus coming to pick you up. There's also usually screens at a lot of the resorts that will have that information. I think the one thing would to keep in mind is if you're going from one resort to another, let's say you have table, you know, service reservations that you're allowed to go to one of the other resorts right now, it's you would have to do going to a park and then from that park to the next one. Or you could get a rideshare service.
And which they do offer. Of course, there's the mini, well, the minivans aren't running right now. But there's Lyft, there's Uber, all, you know, the various rideshare companies. They run throughout the parks and are very easily, and we use them quite often. A lot of times much more efficient than the Disney bus service. As it's nice to have there and it's complimentary for staying there. Sometimes it's nicer when you want to get there in a timely manner.
And sometimes it's a must, too, if you're going to a certain, like when they resume, for example, some of their tours start really early in the morning, that you might not actually be able to get a Disney transportation to the park in time for that, then you could use a ride share for that as well.
If you want to be sure to get to, like, say, the Disney's Hollywood Studios and get that boarding group of Rise of the Resistance, be there in time, you may want a ride share over a Skyliner, questionable on whether you'll get there in time, even though the rope drop is much later than it used to be now, still questionable. And the buses, you're just not sure. So if you're really set on making sure you get that first boarding group or that first group of boarding groups, you may want to think about ride sharing there. So That's it for thank you. That's it for this week. Next week, well, we were supposed to be heading to Anaheim for Star Wars Celebration 2020. Well, you know, this is the situations that they are. This has been one of those years where it's the year of the cancel.
Right.
So, well, I mean, technically it's postponement. They postponed Star Wars Celebration Anaheim to 2022. But that doesn't mean we're not going to still have our own little Star Wars celebration here on the Hyperion Adventures podcast. So we'll be joined by Pat and Charles from the Conversations podcast and our wonderful friend Rob LeBerry from the Jedi Temple Archives podcast. Yep. You may remember that they were on our 100th episode. And we just laughed a lot throughout that one. Well, I expect that will happen again on this show. We'll talk a little bit about Star Wars Celebration. Michelle has an interesting, fun little sort of like if as if it was a Star Wars Celebration panel, kind of a game that we're going to play between all of us. So we're excited to do that. And I think you'll enjoy the fun that we're going to have with all of them.
Yeah, I hope so, too. And as you mentioned, our guests bring a lot of knowledge and a lot of fun and entertainment to our podcast. So we're really looking forward to it. And I'm sure you're going to enjoy it.
Yeah, I think so, too. So that will be a lot of fun. And we appreciate you joined us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
sign up for the newsletter.
Please sign up for the newsletter. I forgot to mention earlier, and I'm can't believe I didn't mention it, but I had so much to get out there. We do have a new category for our Hyperion Adventures Disney Hall of Fame, and it came out in the newsletter this week. It is Best Disney Sidekick. So please, I'll put it out on social media again. Please send us through our social media, through email, whatever the case may be, your top five Disney sidekicks, and we'll put all the nominations in there. The ones who get the most will end up on our final ballot in November and December.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
Yeah. Speaking of social media, you can follow us on social media. We're on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We do have a YouTube channel. Hopefully you're seen this video on YouTube. If you just want to find us, just do a quick search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast. Hit subscribe and you'll know whenever we have a new video out there. And if you ever want to email us, please hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. We love to hear from you. And another way that we really love hearing from you all is through reviews, whether it's a star rating or an actual written review. That really helps us really know what we're doing well. And, you know, it also helps other people find us.
That's the biggest thing for me. No, I really want, we want this show to be the best it can possibly be. So anything, any criticisms, constructive criticism you could give us would be great to help us improve this podcast and be something that you enjoy week in and week out. But really the best way to have people find out about our show is just tell friends.
Yeah.
Just tell your friend that you like this show and that they might like it. And that is how we build this group of this whole Hyperion adventurer family.
Right. And you've done a great job because we continue to grow and we're really impressed by that, that you all have helped us on this journey.
So thank you. Thank you so very much. So that's it. Thank you for listening to the Hyperion Adventures podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Michelle.
And we hope that you have a magical week.
Bye.